Good evening, everyone. How are you? If you were here when our friend Luciana gave the speech, I think it was 2 or 3 weeks ago, Valdo read from Happy Life a passage talking about telling truth. And just hit me, because what is the truth? And is that it's about perception? It's about the real truth? What is that? And how you use it? You tell the truth to help people? You tell the truth to throw your truth in front of them, in the face of them? It is a weapon. It is a medicine. How do you work with the truth? And as a matter of fact, what is the truth? So, as I said, I use Happy Life. I use the Spiritist book and the Gospel According to Spiritism as the base for this talk that we're gonna get together. So if you have any comments, please feel free to shout out, because otherwise it's gonna be a one-way communication, which is not that fun. This is on Gospel According to Spiritism. Man is an incarnated soul. Before his incarnation, he exists to unite the primordial models to the ideas, truth, goodness, and beauty. And we know that when we incarnate, what happens? We forget about everything, right? So if we know the real truth as a spirit, when you come back to Earth and we incarnate, everything is processed by our brain, which is a great, beautiful machine, but doesn't have the capability that we think that it does, especially to remember all the eternal truth. So, because of that, it is hard for us to grasp what is true, what is not, and what is our truth, and what is the eternal or a common truth. Jesus himself, when he came, he adapted his teachings to the conditions of the humanity at that time. Remember, his group was made of what? A fisherman, people that do have a certain skill, but not too much in terms of intellect. Judas was the wisest one among that group. So he couldn't say most of the truths that he knew, because they would not be able to understand. So he used parables. And you interpret the parable as a story, and when you interpret the story, then you get something out of that, which is the top of the iceberg of what he was talking about. But still, the message was sinking in. So, when adapting his teaching to the condition of humanity at the time, Jesus did not consider it convenient to give them all the truth, for he saw they would be dazzled by it and unable to understand. And here's the first question. Are we trying to give the whole thing in once for somebody that cannot do it, cannot get it? That is a story that this famous speaker went to Harvard to give a speech, and he was so, you know, all to himself. And he got to the auditorium, big auditorium, empty. There was just one person. And he looked at the person and said, "You know what? What do you think we should do? That's just you and me. Should I give the lecture?" And the guy said, "I'm not sure, because I'm just a farmer. So if I do have just one chicken, I will feed her." And he got that. "Oh, I got it. I got this metaphor. Brilliant. Fantastic." He did the best presentation ever. Say, "What do you think?" "So, again, I'm a farmer. I just think that if I just have one chicken, I don't get the whole bag of corn." So it's just a matter of crafting the message to the receiver. Not trying to impress anybody with the message. The message has one purpose: for the other one to understand what you're talking about. Just that. You don't need to go with beautiful words and, you know, a big presentation. It's not what the other person needs. It's not what the other person is there to hear. So you have to respect that. Jesus limited himself to offering only the initial part of the truth on many subjects, saying that man as yet could not understand the whole truth. But he talked about all things. He talked, just give the beginning of the truth, but he talked about all things. So he covered pretty much what needs to be done. But he couldn't, can you imagine him telling that there are spirits, discarnated spirits around, and they can influence, there will be devils, right? By the time, and maybe he will be condemned as a sorcerer, because that's the habit of the time. So he could not give everything that he needs or he wanted, because we will not be able to get it. And that's the first hint. Watch. Don't deliver everything because you think that that's what the other one needs to get. This is your truth, not theirs. And then we come to this beautiful passage from John. Know the truth, and the truth will set you free. And if you understand that just by your interpretation of these words, it's a beautiful thing, because when you find out, you finally found out your truth, I'm free, and now I want everybody to know the same truth. Is your truth the same as mine? But we're so embedded, we're so happy, contaminated with this, that we want everybody to know this truth. And sometimes no matter what. So I coined the word that doesn't belong to any vocab, any dictionary, called sincere side. You can be sincere. You don't need to commit suicide with that sincerity. Don't be sincere side. Don't do this. Your truth can help people, but if you push this truth to somebody, you are killing. Your truth, you are killing sometimes your whole relationship with this person, just because they don't want you to hear everything that you think that they do. Speak the truth does not mean speaking everything. And that doesn't mean that you're not speaking the truth because you're not saying everything. You're still speaking the truth to a certain extent that the other one will understand. And you're not going to be perceived as somebody that is pushing or that is saying, this is my truth. You have to follow that. Otherwise, you're out. And sometimes that's how people understand what we're saying. Unfortunately, it is. However, do not take our own opinion and try to prove it true. You can cut to the chase in a conversation, not burden a child with more than he or she can understand. Be civil when you're angry and not spew your guts in a meeting. Nor should you confide more than is appropriate. What is appropriate? What is a balance? Are you balanced or unbalanced? Well, most of the time unbalanced. For real, because all the stimuli that we have outside just make us crazy. How long does it take for us to settle down and sit here? And we know that this place is prepared for the spirit since the early morning. So believe it or not, the chair that you sit was prepared for you. You don't know that. They do know that. So when you sit here before the meeting starts, that's when they start prepping you for the night. They start calming you down. They start giving you the spiritual passes if you want. And then you're going to receive the regular pass after all. But they prepare you to absorb, not just here, but here, the message. And craft that. What can I do with this? Is this message... If you get one thing out of the whole presentation, not just mine, but anyone's, you come out of here better than when we came in. And that's the meaning. Yours may not be the legitimate truth, or else this will not be the complete truth. On the introduction of the gospel according to Spiritism, there is a passage that say, that is what we have based ourselves when formulating a principle for the doctrine. We do not insist on it being truth. Nobody throws your Spiritism in the face of anybody saying, this is the truth. The other religions don't tell the truth. No. And this was crafted in the beginning of the Gospel according to Spiritism. We do not insist on being the truth just because it might be in accordance with our own ideas. This is the line. I'm not going to push you my truth just because I think it is. And that's what they're saying about the doctrine itself. Neither do we have the least desire to uphold ourselves as being the sole possessor of the whole truth. And we have never said to anyone, believe in this because it is I who tell you. Salvation. What is the sentence for salvation in Spiritism? You only find salvation, or you only find your relief as a soul when you practice charity. There's no salvation outside of charity. The other ones is there's no salvation outside the church. You can be charitable anywhere, not only when you are in the church. So, unfortunately, again, some truths will give you some space for slacking. So, good. So, there's no salvation outside the church. I'm only going to be the good guy when I'm at the church. When I'm out, hey, party time. And again, this is the truth about the parable of the 10 lepers. When the 10 lepers were cured, just one came back. And what Jesus told him, you're the only one that's going to be cured. Because the other ones, I cured the external side. But the internal side, which was caused the leper, was not healed. So they're going to develop leper again. The only truth is the truth that heals you. But you don't need to push to others. And sometimes when somebody tells us the truth, we react just like that, right? Oh my God. Really? You're telling me this? So the question is, have I become your enemy by telling you the truth? If I did, I probably didn't convey the best words to telling you my truth. That is a great quote from Ted Roosevelt. That he said that, bring your enemies close, but so close that there will be a point that you ask yourself, are they still my enemies? Because they're so close. Enemies I want to see far from me. So if I put them close to myself, are they still my enemies? My perception will change. So the perception of truth will change as well. Depends the way that you convey your message. Some people use the truth to hurt others. But truth, in fact, it's a light that clarifies things without hurting anyone. It's like food that we must eat in the right amount, or like water that we drink in the right amount. And these teachings are so powerful that if you analyze the human body through science, first of all, each 2 years, we change 99% of our body. It's new, it's renewed. So if your organ is sick and it's been renewed, why is it still sick? Because it renews the exterior of the organ, but not the substance that is being generated and is making the organ sick. That is probably generated by our brain, our feelings. It's crazy. It's truth. If I come here and tell a big audience about you are responsible for your, am I telling the truth? Yes, I am. Am I helping anyone? No, I'm not. I'm sorry, I'm not. I'm not consoling, I'm not giving any way for them to be relieved. Of course, we know that we can cause all the problems inside of ourselves. We do have the placebo effect inside ourselves. We can fabricate a lot of good things and a lot of bad things. And also our intestine system, it's so powerful that it generates 90% of the serotonin of that comes to our brain. Serotonin responsible for stress, lack of less stress, and focus. 50% of the dopamine, prediction of pleasure, plus 30 other neurotransmitters. So when you watch, like they're saying here, it's like food that we must eat in the right amount. Because if you overload your intestine, this function goes down the drain. Because you need attention to make the digestion, to help with the digestion. And sometimes you get sick. So it's just one little detail, but affects the whole system. Use the truth with the aim of helping, never as a weapon of aggression or retaliation. Makes sense, guys. The truth fed us, calm us, and make us happy, making us more understanding and kind. But we should never use the truth to hurt others, as if we were a weapon. If we do this, the truth loses the purpose, which is to liberate. We do that more than we want it. We do that every day. Don't want you guys to share examples if you don't want it, but I'm going to share mine today. My wife is working in with the group and the company that she works for that she really don't like. And if I really use the truth word, she hates. And again, for the, I don't know, 998,000 times, she came with the same sentence to me. So such and such told me this and this and blah, blah, blah. She wants to borrow my ears. But I was not understanding that. So Peter went to tell the truth. What do you think that happens? Third World War. Because I was not apparently seeing what's happening. I told her, why do you keep letting them get to your nerves? The choice is yours. Oh, that's exactly what she wants to hear. That is the truth. Nevertheless, that is the truth. But that's not what she was coming to hear. We guys come back home after a day and we kill a lion, a bobcat, and a leopard, and we're tired. And then comes our wife and start talking about her day. And the man's brain goes, oh, here we go, another lion to kill. And she start talking about the problems. And she breathes and say, did you try this? Yes. And she keeps talking. And she breathes again. Did you try that? Yes. And it goes on and on and on up to a point that she said, I don't want you to tell me what I should do. And you, on your side, because you're so attentive, you're so kind, say, so what do you want? Done. Done. Done for the night. I hope you have a better couch than mine. That's how it is. Why don't you tell the truth the way it's not? Don't tell the whole truth. Because she knows that. She's always asking you to hear. At this time, I used to be the guy that tried to do, because, come on guys, you have the power of getting to in front of us when the movie is about to end, or my team is about to score a goal. It's amazing. Amazing. But we try to multitask. Bad thing. Bad thing. It doesn't work like this. It's like one eye on the cat, other one on the fish. And when you start doing the third you're dead. You're not paying attention to me. Yes, I am. So tell me what you just said. No, it's not. End of conversation. So now, out of my will, but to preserve the truth the way it should be peaceful, I turn off the TV. And sometimes a miracle happens. She gets so, you know, in touch with me, said, no, keep watching, I'll talk later. Said, oh, I want this one. I don't know what's happened, but I want this one. I can watch my game. Because you understand, you understood the her truth. She wants to talk. She doesn't want you to talk back. She wants you to remember why God gives you 2 ears and just one mouth. Period. Isn't that hard? Yes, it is. I'm sorry. For us, it is. But we learn. That's why we're here, right? Planet Earth. Let's go. The truth is like a diamond. It requires adequate wrapping to keep it safe. And when we throw at someone, not hurt them. It's not just what you say, it's how you say. You can say the same thing in so many different ways. But we're so tired. We're so agitated. We're so this and we're so that. So if we are all of these, stop. Don't say it. Bite your tongue. The mess that can happen, you're going to hurt your tongue, you're going to bleed a little bit, but you heal. At least mine did. So yours probably will heal as well. So if you're not prepared to deal with somebody else's truth, don't try to use your truth as a weapon. Before positioning yourself as someone who corrects and teaches, with the truth, think about the other person's point of view to whom you are speaking. If I draw it's not easy. It's not easy because you're going to fight against your pride. Because I'm seeing a 6. And I don't care if you're seeing a 9. You should understand my point of view. Ooh. Hard. And again, don't think that you can walk on somebody's shoes. You can't because you're not that person. You don't have the same DNA. You can be on the side of this person and understand his or her point of view. And that's all you can do. Because they think about empathy. Oh, empathy is to put yourself in the place of the other. Not on planet Earth. Physics are here. The same body cannot occupy the same space at the same time. Two bodies cannot occupy the same place at the same time. Sorry, it doesn't work like this. And even if you can, I'm going to throw you to the side. Let's pretend that I'm an obsessor and I put your soul to the side. I put your spirit to the side. Still occupying one place with my point of view, not yours. So understand that your point of view is mainly the source of most of the problems that we carry on. Do you agree? Anybody has something to share?
I would say that I noticed today that most of the people, they are not trying to understand the other person's truth. They're just trying to impose whatever. It's their truth.
And what do you think that is?
There's no discussion. I don't know, pride or I don't know.
So again, pride. And it's fun because we are, we see so many stickers. Proud parents of a third grader, proud this, proud that. Where the proud gets its limit. You can be proud. I think right now, I'm not sure, but that is a lot of countries going against Facebook. And it's not Facebook's problem. It's just a place. But everybody's happy on Facebook. There's no problems on Facebook. And kids are committing suicide because of that. And because of bullying and because of things that happens on social media. They don't understand the like as something has no meaning. If they not get a like, they feel that they left over. And they feel depressed. And depression, level 3, takes somebody to suicidal thoughts. It's hard, guys. It's not something that is... and. This is their truth. I work with the suicidal line in Brazil, and I heard like kids of 12, 13, 14 telling me that they are thinking about giving up life because of grades. What kind of truth they have in life? What kind of vision maybe they don't share? This past weekend, we had a conference with some speakers from Brazil. And one of them was Dr. Alberto Almeida. And he was telling the tale about, he do the youth education on the center that he works with. And there was a kid, a girl, that she went to the place that they have a lot of fruits and vegetables and stuff. And kids don't, are not allowed to get there. But she got in and she looked at him and he looked at her, he said nothing. She went to the tomato tree, look at him, he looked at her, no word. She grabbed the tomato, the green tomato, look at him, no word. Give it a bite, look at him, no word. And what she did? She threw the tomato on him. What is the truth there? She wants to be validated as a person. She's not a bad behavior person. She wants to be validated. And because he was looking at her and didn't say anything, now she feels less than what she was when she went to the place. So, how many times our kids do that? How many times our parents do that? How many times our boss do that? Our peers do that? It's their truth. It's not yours. It's hard to understand. But it is true for them. And if you have a moment to validate the humanity, probably this truth will change. Probably you can do something way better than you think you can. Sometimes it's not a matter of giving food to a homeless. It's to sit on his side and see, and talk to him while he eats. Because he feels less than nothing. And when you sit on his side, he feels somebody for a brief moment. But that's what you can offer. And both of you will feel awesome. But we don't have too much time to do that sometimes. And that is the truth that hurts. I'm not using this truth to hurt you, but to make you understand that there are many possibilities to work with somebody else's truth, validating it. And that's mostly what they want. Sometimes they don't want to throw in your face. It's just because they are so frustrated that nobody hears them, that they use that as a weapon. Preserve it for the appropriate moment in which you can dignify and lift up those who fall or are rushing into the abyss of madness and illusion. you will be much more complete if you refrain to tell the whole truth. No, you're not Jesus. No, you don't have the same understanding that he does. But yes, you can understand the situation. And if I spell the whole truth, if I spill all my beans, what's going to be? What the reaction will be? What is the outcome? Will I please somebody or just myself? And that's the truth about telling truth. Your truth is truth for yourself, maybe not for the other. Respect that. Work with that. And when somebody tries to tell the truth or throw his truth on you, understand where he comes or she comes from. Which is not you. She's not trying to, you know, go against you. But you are the one that was there by the time that she needs to say something. It's been 14 years that I do fraternal assistance here. And I regret to tell that sometimes I commit suicide. Because the person came one too many times. And we keep all the documents, all the messages that the spirits gave, psychographed to them. And the pattern was the same. The same thing. Stress or whatever, angry 3 years ago, 4 years ago, 5 years ago, angry yesterday, angry the month before. You come all the time with the same problem, and all these pages tells you what you do to change that. What did you do? Is that a way to help somebody? Yeah. Unfortunately, I did. And I'm guilty of that. We're not perfect. But if you understand that you can perfect yourself, that's the reason that we incarnate in this planet. I'm going to throw you a truth real hard. I have a good and a bad news for you. Which one you prefer, Brett, in the first place? The bad. All of us are bad. We are not in a beautiful place. We are not among saints. We're all on the dirty road. You know what's the truth? That the good is? We came here to better ourselves. And that's all we can do. A plan of trials and atonements. It's not for beautiful, perfect beings. They come to try to help us. And they go. But unfortunately, it's not us. And we know pretty much inside ourselves what you did last summer. Right? It's not a thriller. It's your personal thriller. What you did yesterday, what you didn't do. And you have to live with that. Forget no, but forgive yourself. Because one of the questions that in the end of the assessment that we do is like, do you have problems in forgiving? No, I forgive everybody. And then here comes the truth. And what about yourself? Some people say, oh. Some people say, Some people don't say anything, just look down. So again, why do you charge yourself with? Why you feel guilty of? Because in order to forgive somebody, you have to have forgiveness. Especially with you. Again, forgive is not to forget. You did. It was not good. You're trying to get better. But this is the truth. This is your personal truth. You don't go out and say, hey, I did this much bad things in my life. No. You don't broadcast that. But you know that you did. You know that you're not perfect, so you're not going to play the role of being Mr. Perfect, Mr. Right. There's no Mr. Right. That's the right that fits to your life. That's the right that fits to your truth. Man has now reached a point when the light emerged from beneath the bushes of his own accord, because he has reached sufficient maturity to be able to meet the truth face to face. And it will be worse for those who do not wish to see this. When you don't know something, I cannot charge you on it, can I? I didn't tell you. But now you know, and you keep doing it. Whose fault is that? So the Gospel According to Spiritism is telling that in the 1800s, when it was written, humanity was ready to know the truth. And so far, we're still struggling with the truth. We're still struggling. We be more helpful. We understand people. We help people. Because normally what we get out there is what? A slap in the face. And then when you got slap in the face, you want to slap it back. And we're back to before Christ. Eye for an eye. We have to control this kind of attitude, but inside of us is not something that you just do because everybody's looking at. The greatest thing that you do is when nobody looking. Like, this is Joel Osteen. I don't know if you know the pastor. He has a stadium in Texas. And he was telling that this gallons of water, and we clean it up before we put on the water tank. And his wife not just want him to clean the lid, but clean the whole thing, which is more effort to do it. So his wife was not there. And of course, he was tempted to just clean the tip and put it up because she's not there to see. And he felt so guilty that he started cleaning everything. So he came up with this. So character moral is when nobody's looking at you and you're still doing it because you believe in it. Even if it's because you believe that your wife will like it. Doesn't matter. In this sense, you're doing right. Do it right. You know what is right. You know what is wrong. And right is right, even if just one person is doing. And wrong is wrong, even if everybody else is doing. We are dragged for the crowd because we are social creatures, but the crowd cannot dictate our lives. Otherwise, we're not going to be a different DNA, each one of us, a different print in your thumbnail. We are different. We have to exercise this difference. Why have so many ancient modern philosophers discussed psychological science for so long without arriving at the truth? Because they want to prove they aren't truth. They don't want to prove that that is multiple truth. They want to prove that they are right because I study so much, so I'm right. This is the question 145 of the Spiritist book. Being human and therefore subject to error, they have mistaken their own ideas for the light. The same errors, however, have served to bring the truth to light through the pros and cons of their doctrine. So even when you do something wrong, that is right on wrong. Because otherwise you were never going to discuss that. So if that is what it takes to sparkle this discussion, so be it. By the way, a comparative study would enable you to understand that in the midst of the error, there is great truth. Spirit saying that, in the midst of the error, there is great truth. Positioning, point of view, understanding, why are we fighting? Why are we committing this error? What is a sin? We put so much power into the word sin, didn't we? And sin in Hebrew means missing the target. So light compared to what we think about sin. It's missing the target. I aim for that and I hit that. I missed that one. So, admit that you err and move on. It's hard because we have something called pride. And our author, you may, most of you know him, he has an acronym for ego, edging God out. So an ego comes, God goes out. A thing may be true or false according to the meaning given to the words. What comes out of your mouth doesn't come back. So use the lumberjack motto. Measure twice and cut once, because the price of the lumber is expensive. Always measure twice before saying. The greatest truth may seem absurd when the only form is observed and when the allegory is taken for reality. See, if you just observe the way that it was told, like how many times you get a text on WhatsApp or email and you interpret with your voice 100% of the time, because there's no other way. But it's not the voice that the person wrote. So I love Graham Bell because he created the telephone for you to talk, not to write. So if I need to clarify something, I call. At least he's going to hear my tone of voice and not going to interpret the words the way his brain is set up for that moment. And again, my friends, know the truth, and the truth will set you free. We don't know the whole truth. As Jesus said, I gave them the initial part of the truth. Now we're getting more of the truth. But understand that because you feel that it's truth, your partner, the person on your side, might not. And that is okay. That is okay. That is not the final truth. The only thing that we know for sure is that we're going to sometime in the future, we're going to discarnate. And that's all. The rest, it's up for grabs. So that is not a final truth. This guy here thought he knew the truth. And he paid for it, right? Because he was saying, imagine if there was no countries.
Imagine there's no heaven. It's easy if you try.
Unfortunately, his truth bothers somebody else. And that's the world we live in. It's not a great world, it's not a bad world. It's the world that we chose to come to perfect ourselves and to perfect our truth. So, first of all, be true to yourself, but understand that your truth is not everybody's truth.